Melissa Etheridge was a small-town girl with big-city dreams.
From the moment I heard the Beatles on my transistor radio singing I Want to Hold Your Hand in 1964, I said, that's it, that's for me.
But rock wasn't ready to roll for a girl with a guitar.
I was a little out of place.
On this edition of Celebrity Profile, find out how Melissa Etheridge crashed through the boys-only barrier.
Melissa comes in with her guitar and absolutely blows, you know, does a couple of songs and blows everybody away.
It's just insane rock music with this incredible voice.
I think when she gets up on stage, she is like a reincarnation of Janis Joplin.
Discover why this bold, dynamic performer struggled to keep a secret.
I'm telling you the truth, but I'm not really, it just took so much energy.
See where she found the courage to come out.
Listen, it's okay. I'm famous and I'm with you. I'm gay and I have a lover.
And then the babies.
That journey, that responsibility, and that love, and that devotion that I never knew I had.
And those rumors about the father.
We heard Brad Pitt. That was the big one.
In a candid interview, Melissa sets the record straight, so to speak.
Sure, dude. Okay, whatever.
This is Melissa Etheridge, Celebrity Profile.
A lot of people look at my career and my experience of coming out. They see I came out. I sold 6 million, 10 million records. It was a complete success. You can't look at my experience of coming out saying that it hurt me in any way.
Ask Melissa Etheridge and she'll tell you the truth set her free. She's a singer-songwriter whose passionate lyrics speak volumes about her life. For this controversial rocker, the music began in Leavenworth, Kansas. Melissa Lou Etheridge was born on May 29, 1961. Her dad, John, was a high school teacher, and mom, Elizabeth, was a civil servant for the armed forces.
They both were very hard workers and really instilled in me that I should and I need to be self-sufficient and I need to work hard and sort of this Midwestern work ethic. I think one of my earliest memories would be, I must have been two or three years old, and it was like doing one of those 2-3-year-old kid dances in the living room, and there was like friends over or guests over, and all of a sudden they were all looking at me, and I got that rush of, oh, everybody's looking at me. And I think that's when I got hooked. My favorite form of play when I was a young child was to gather my friends together and pretend we were a rock and roll band. Bring the badminton rackets out and we'd jump around and we'd put the song on the 45 and I'd sing. I always was the one that was out in front, and I always played the guitar too, even though there were no women at the time that were playing guitar and singing. That didn't click in me. I wanted to do that. That was what I was going to do.
Childhood friend Mike Strange.
She told me she was going to be a star. And there was no reason not to believe her at that point because she was fairly talented already.
I've always had this crazy notion that I was going to be a rock star. From the moment I heard the Beatles on my transistor radio singing I Want to Hold Your Hand in 1964, I said, that's it, that's for me.
In 1969, Melissa's dad gave his daughter the best gift a budding rock star could hope for.
My father brought home a guitar one day. I don't remember asking him for it. I think he was just aware that I was jumping around with a badminton racket, that I was listening to the records. I think he just thought it might be a good thing, and he brought it home and set me up with lessons. I started writing my own songs. I was 10 years old. They were completely adolescent, not even adolescent, they were juvenile and simple, and just copies of what I was hearing, the folk rock pop music that I was hearing at the time. But I started writing words down and making things up.
friend Cara Bray.
She would write songs to make the girls cry. It was very, very much a storyteller, and it's very, very much about deep emotional type of things.
When she was 12, Melissa joined a local country western band, Chuck Hammersmith and the Wranglers.
They heard me sing at this variety show, and they asked if I wanted to join. The first time I got up in front of people and sang a song, and they danced or applauded or got drunk or whatever they were doing, it was my first experience with that, and I loved it.
You could tell she was destined for stardom, and if you couldn't tell, she'd tell you.
Melissa's father accompanied his young performer to her gigs.
He didn't quite know if this was a good thing or not to have his daughter in these bars, but he knew that if he was there, he could at least watch and take care. And I would not be the performer I am today if my father hadn't supported me in that way.
But Dad wasn't around all the time, especially when Melissa hung out with her buddy, Mike Strange.
We went from chasing each other around the playground to, you know, fifth grade, sixth grade, first kiss. We were boyfriend and girlfriend a little bit in junior high, and then we were friends.
Once we hit high school, the later years in high school, we kind of discovered other people and became more brother and sister than anything else.
Melissa soon entered into relationships that were more than platonic.
It seems my birthdays are kind of landmarks in my life, and my, there were a lot of first kisses in my life. Mike Strange was my first kiss, but my first kiss where I realized I was of an alternative sexuality was on my 17th birthday with my best friend in high school. The first time I kissed a girl, it was like, you know, the heavens opened up, and it was like, oh, okay, I understand. I didn't understand, but I knew that I was on a different path than most.
In the 1970s, being different often meant being confused.
Growing up in an emotionally repressed household, it was definitely a sexually repressed. I mean, there wasn't even any discussion of any sort of sexuality. So that, coupled with the fact that I was now attracted to the same sex, what does this mean? What, it was a very confusing time.
Coming up, Melissa has a heart-to-heart with Dad.
And I sat him down and I built him up and, okay, I'm going to tell you this.
And later.
I got a call at the office one day, and it was Melissa, and she was crying.
I'll go before night is through.
It was more. In May 1979, Melissa Etheridge was a high school graduate ready to leave Leavenworth, Kansas to make it in rock and roll. Just what any parent loves to hear.
They knew I had this crazy dream of being a musician and a rock star or something, and they didn't discourage me, but they also wanted to make sure I had something to fall back on. So I said, college, okay, but it has to be a music college.
Melissa headed to Berklee College of Music in Boston.
So to me, it was a ticket out of Leavenworth. They paid for the college. I was grateful. I was in Boston now, and I was very happy. I felt very free, and I was meeting people in the gay community, which was huge for me.
Melissa hooked up with a new circle of friends, and she was taken to her first gay bar.
Walked in, and they were all dancing and talking, and it was fabulous. I had never seen anything like that in my life.
Socially, Melissa was thriving, dating up a storm. But academically, well, that was another story.
I found studying music was not very rewarding for me. Looking back, I wish I'd studied more, but I know that what was in my heart was a stronger drive than that. It was a drive to perform, to write, to learn, to experience.
Etheridge quit school after one semester. She took jobs playing guitar in restaurants and clubs.
When I told my parents, you know, I'm checking out, they were like, well, as long as you're supporting yourself, that's fine. You know, they were a little disappointed, but they were okay.
About a year later, Melissa moved back to Leavenworth.
I had amazing experiences. I grew a lot. I was no longer a child. I returned. Ran out of money. You go home. Everybody goes home for a minute, and they remember why they left, and then they're gone for good. But I had to go home, resituate myself, look at my dreams, look at what I was going to do, make some more money.
And tell her father about her sexual orientation.
I sat him down, And I built him up, and okay, I'm going to tell you this, and it's something that's really, you know, hard for me, and I don't know if you're going to understand. And he was just all, what? And I said, you know, I'm gay. And he said, I know that. Is that all, you know? And it was just the sense that we never talked, and the communication was not there in my family, and this was finally, okay, you know it, I know it, okay, now I can go on.
The talk with her mother didn't happen until years later.
We finally sat down and communicated, had a drink and talked about it, and she said, you know, I don't understand it, but fine.
In the summer of 1982, 21-year-old Melissa set her sights on Los Angeles.
I left Leavenworth, and I could put everything I owned in my car. It's a very, very free time when you can put everything you own in your car. And I drove out there, and I was free of any attachments to anyone. I was completely responsible for me, and I was driving out, meeting my destiny, my future.
But the singer with big dreams experienced a rude awakening when she got to L.A.
There wasn't a lot of space for a girl with a guitar. There was a lot of hairspray and heavy metal guitars at that time. I was a little out of place. A lot of big hair bands on the Sunset Strip.
Melissa found her niche when she happened upon a neighborhood bar that catered to lesbians.
I thought, well, here's a bar, here's a piano, do you have live music? They said, yeah, sometimes. You know, and people weren't lining up to go play gay bars. So I said, well, can I audition? And they said, sure.
Melissa felt right at home in this environment. So she began to bar hop as a performer. One of her favorite clubs was the Que Sera in Long Beach, California. Owner, Ilsa Benz.
Melissa did not have a demo tape or a promo package, and so she really got hired without me listening to a tape or any of her original music.
There were people that would come every Wednesday night to the Que Sera from 8 to 11 just to hear me play, and they would start requesting my original songs. And that meant so much to me. That meant that people were remembering and wanting to hear the songs that I wrote.
She worked here for 4.5 years, and I do not ever recall a time when Melissa was late or even missed one of her performances. Of course, that could be that she really needed the $50 that she got paid just to have something to eat. But she was my best employee ever.
Best and most popular, with a faithful fan club, including the members of a women's soccer team who came to hear Melissa sing again and again.
One of the few straight women on the team was married to someone in the music business.
That someone was artist manager Bill Leopold.
My wife and a bunch of her friends kept bugging me to go see this girl play in a club, and I wouldn't do it. I was not interested.
Leopold finally caved.
I went to see this young lady, and I literally thought I'd seen the reincarnation of Judy Garland. Her music was so passionate. She was so passionate.
He had a meeting with me immediately and signed me.
Melissa continued playing the Que Sera until 1986, when she got her big break. Island Records founder Chris Blackwell stopped by and caught her act.
She goes, Ben, tonight somebody important is going to stop by. Could you be so nice enough and not charge him for his cocktail? And he listened to approximately 2 or 3 of her original songs.
He walked into this women's bar, Que Sera in Long Beach, and he had his beach pants and flip-flops on, and he was English. And I met him during the break, and he said, I think the future of rock and roll has a female face. I want you on my record label. Sure, dude, okay, whatever.
Blackwell helped launch the careers of Bob Marley, Robert Palmer, and U2. He signed the 26-year-old and put her to work recording an album. Melissa was frank with Blackwell about her sexuality. He advised her to keep her private life private. Blackwell instructed Melissa to focus on the album.
I was scared to death when I finally got the opportunity, and here you go, and I'd been a solo artist, and how do I put my songs with musicians, and what's a producer, and who are you, and all these keyboards. It was the end of the 80s. It was really slick.
But the finished product wasn't exactly what Blackwell wanted from his protege.
I thought, that's it. I've blown my chance. It's over. And I had done a photo shoot for the record, and was in my leather jacket, my white t-shirt, and all my 80s jewelry, and was dancing around with my spiky hair, and got this really picture that was full of a lot of emotion. And he took that picture and he said, make this record. And he put it down in the studio and he said, you have 4 days. Okay, and I went in with the drummer and the bass player, and the three of us produced my first record in 4 days. And it's live and it's real, and it's what Chris Blackwell loved about me.
The self-titled debut album came out in the spring of 1987. Melissa's music reflected her break from a stifling childhood in Leavenworth, Kansas.
I felt very powerful. I was kind of crazy, and I was writing about it. And the songs, Bring Me Some Water, Like the Way I Do, similar features. These are songs of intense want and desire and sexuality. This is, I had been repressed all my life, and finally I was out and living it and feeling it and writing about it. I was still writing all the things that I couldn't say.
But the music world didn't embrace the dynamic newcomer.
Rock and roll music has always been a boys' club. It still is. There's been very few women that have really broken through.
Well, it was the end of the 80s now, and here's this girl with an acoustic guitar who writes her own songs, singing rock and roll. And there was that playlist of rock and roll stations that had a lot of hair bands, a lot of rock guys, and, well, we already have a woman on our playlist, Stevie Nicks.
We would drag these program directors to her live shows, and once they saw the show, they would be in. They would get into the record and start playing the record.
Coming up, Melissa falls hard.
And I was like, wow, I dig you.
But the road to true love has a giant bump.
And then all of a sudden she says something about her husband, and I just, uh-oh.
By the end of 1988, rocker Melissa Etheridge was making some noise on the radio. Programmers began playing her first single, Bring Me Some Water.
Somebody bring me some water. Can't you see I'm burning alive? Can't you see my baby's got another lover? And I don't know how I'm going to survive.
There I was going to make my first video, you know. And I remember rolling out of the bus, getting ready to shoot the video during the day, and they were going to shoot the show that night. And I was introduced, this is the assistant director, she's going to look out after you today, and her name is Julie Seifert. And she was incredibly attractive, powerful, strong woman. And I was like, wow, I dig you. And we got along great.
There was a definite attraction with one major hurdle.
And then all of a sudden she says something about her husband, and I just went, uh-oh, what? I hadn't even considered that she was married.
Seifert's husband was actor Lou Diamond Phillips. The women kept their relationship platonic as Melissa grew close to both Julie and Lou. In fact, the three worked together on Melissa's next video, Angels. In January of 1989, her hit single, Bring Me Some Water, was nominated for a Grammy, and Melissa was asked to perform at the award ceremony.
One of the biggest breaks I've had in my career has been that first Grammy nomination. I was nominated in the category of Best Female Rock Performance. And I remember it was Tina Turner who won, because she was Tina Turner. And then it was myself, Tony Childs, and this crazy bald-headed chick named Sinead O'Connor.
Bring Me Some Water kept growing and growing and growing and growing, and became kind of an anthem through the fall. And by the time she was asked to play on the Grammys, Melissa comes in with her guitar and absolutely blows, you know, does a couple of songs and blows everybody away.
It really opened up my career. You can look back at the numbers. The next week, my album sales just, no one, I mean, they didn't know who I was. And then there I was singing, and they responded.
The hot streak continued with Etheridge's second album, Brave and Crazy.
But if you want me, you can call me. In the night, you know where I'll be.
In the fall of 89, Melissa kicked off a European tour, but her thoughts were on a certain someone back in the States. When Melissa came home, she heard that Julie and Lou were breaking up.
The experience of those 2 years while she was coming out of her marriage and we were coming together, we were friends. And then when they separated, you know, we started dating, and it was about a year and a half of her figuring out her life and us coming back together. It was the beginning of my career and her career. It was an amazing time in both of our lives.
For the first time in her life, Melissa wanted to be a one-woman girl.
I knew when I met her and we came together that there wasn't any messing around with this one, that I was going to do the right thing. And all my reasons for being non-monogamous or dating a lot or whatever you want to call it went away. I could put my energy, my focus, my love, my lust, my respect, everything in this one person.
In 1991, the couple moved in together and Melissa began work on her third album. Everything seemed perfect until that spring.
I was actually in the studio making Never Enough when I got a call from my parents telling me that my father had inoperable cancer and he was dying.
I got a call at the office one day, one afternoon, and it was Melissa, and she was crying, and she told me that, you know, her father was really close to passing.
I'd never really brought into my life the fact that my parents were mortal and that someday they would die. And my life was going well, and everything was fine, and this, and especially my father, always had such a connection with him.
In March of 1992, Etheridge released Never Enough, which explored Melissa's grief over the loss of her dad.
When my father died, it affected me, so it affects my music. You find it in the pieces after that. You find it in Dance Without Sleeping. You find it in Talking to My Angel, which is just a song about my father and the whole relationship.
Dance without sleeping, I'll dance till I'm numb. Dance till I think I can overcome.
Coming up.
I was actually scared to death for her.
And later.
It's just the greatest thing that's ever happened to me.
At the end of 1992, Melissa Etheridge went on tour to promote her third album, Never Enough. Her music was known for its gritty honesty. Melissa's personal life, however, remained a secret.
I finally started getting those questions that were beyond the music questions. People started to want to know more about me. And I would give them the answer of, well, my partner and I, or who's this song about? Well, it's about them and they, and when I felt this way about them, and I was very genderless and constantly painting these sort of just, I'm telling you the truth, but I'm not really, and it just took so much energy.
Melissa knew it was time to throw open that closet door.
I was out to my family, to friends, to everyone in the business. Half the audience knew where I came from. It was kind of this, okay, who am I dancing for? And why? What am I so afraid of?
Actress and friend, Kathy Najimy.
It's the right thing to do. Because all being in the closet is coming from fear. It's afraid people aren't going to like you, they're not going to buy your music, you're going to be, shut out of the music business and all those other things. And those are all things that you can't control. Those all come from fear. And I think what she could control was telling the truth.
Melissa got the push she needed when a magazine article suggested she was hiding something.
And I decided then and there, you know what, I'm going to come out. And I just sort of was like, okay, how am I going to do this?
In January 1993, Melissa attended the Triangle Ball, a party for gay and lesbian supporters of President Bill Clinton.
And at this inaugural ball, my friend Katie Lang is up there, all out and proud, and she introduces me.
And I'm proud to say right now, I'm very proud to have been a lesbian all my life.
I didn't know I was going to do it then. It was of the moment. I can't think of a better way of coming out than to thunderous applause.
Singer and friend, Elton John.
She was trying to help people, and she didn't help an enormous amount of people come to terms with their sexuality and say, listen, it's okay. I'm famous, and I'm with you. I'm gay and I have a lover.
Actress and friend, Laura Dern.
She's so multifaceted as a rock star. She's healthy. She gets it. She wants to be a good person. She lives her life in her truth.
I was actually scared to death for her. I didn't know she was going to come out when she came out. I was very concerned about her coming out and what it was going to do to her career.
Just 1 month later, Melissa won her first Grammy for the song Ain't It Heavy from her Never Enough album. She was already busy working on her next record.
Yes, I Am was very similar to my first record in that it was about sex. It was about love. It was about betrayal or fear of betrayal. There was a lot of dark themes in it. There was, my father's death was still hanging around. There was a lot of examining my childhood.
Yes, I Am was released in the fall of 93 to instant success. Coming out didn't seem to hurt Melissa's record sales. The rocker went from selling 900,000 albums in 1992 to 6 million with Yes, I Am. The title song explored Melissa's feelings for Julie Cypher.
I wrote the song Yes, I Am before it came out. The song Yes, I Am was about a proclamation of love, about this sort of crazy, you know, am I your passion, your promise, your end? Yes, I am. And when I was putting the album together after I came out, I said, oh, wouldn't that be funny if the album was titled Yes, I Am? That would, and I said, absolutely, of course I'm going to do that, you know.
She did it. Out and proud, Melissa returned home to Kansas in 1994.
I came back to Leavenworth and played my high school auditorium, which was crazy. You know, I wasn't an artist that was going, oh, right, look at me, you know, I showed you, because that's not what I was about even back then. But it was sort of an embracing of, here's my hometown, I am as out as you can be, big homo, and here's the mayor giving me a plaque saying thank you, and it's Melissa Etheridge Day.
Coming up, Melissa rocks the cradle.
I had a certain amount of success. What was the meaning of all this?
And later, just who fathered this child?
You know, Tom Hanks, Bruce Springsteen, my idol. Well, of course, I'd ask him to father my children.
In February of 1995, Melissa Etheridge won a second Grammy for Best Female Rock Performance for Come to My Window.
Winning for Come to My Window was a big, big thing for me, and I was absolutely excited. And you can't even compare your first Grammy with your second Grammy. Being nominated is always amazing. Winning is icing on the cake.
It says that, you know, your peers have said to you, this is really, really a good record.
Another good record was in the works in the spring of 95, and that fall, Your Little Secret was released. Stop playing those eyes.
There's a fun sense to it. There's also a sense of embracing my past. There's a look back, Nowhere to Go, Shriners Park, kind of, wow, here I am where I always wanted to be, and let's look at that journey and how it was.
Melissa had a new journey on her mind. She and Julie were thinking about starting a family.
Even in an alternative relationship, even with homosexuals, straights, you start looking at your life. I had a certain amount of success. What is the meaning of all this?
But before they could get serious, the singer had a concert tour to do.
The tour for Yes, I Am sort of just became the tour for Your Little Secret. It was all one big four-year tour. How are you doing?
In June of 96, Melissa took a short break to go home and be with Julie. The couple soon had a little secret of their own. Julie became pregnant through artificial insemination. Within a few weeks, Melissa reluctantly returned to the road to finish her concert dates.
By the end of Your Little Secret, by the end of 96, I was tired. I had played. I was done. I had achieved the dream. I was in the big arenas playing to the thousands of screaming people. It was great. It was a dream come true. And I was tired.
Tired and lonely.
Neither of us knew what a pregnancy would be like, and I wished I'd have been home more. I think it was her first pregnancy. I think she felt she was going through a lot alone. And I really missed her. It was a hard tour the last few months of that. I wanna go.
February 1997, Julie gave birth to a daughter, Bailey.
Actually, having a baby, having a child in your arms, and that experience, and that journey, and that responsibility, and that love, and that devotion that I never knew I had.
Tour manager and friend Stephen Germont offered support to the couple.
I think it was the whole gamut of experiences, from excitement to fear to just amazement, and just to bring another life into the world was a thrill.
After Bailey was born, Melissa decided to take time off.
I did. I knew that I wanted to be with my child. I knew it was important that it's not, you don't just drop in on your children. You are there for them.
The experience was so fulfilling that Melissa and Julie decided to do it again. In November 1998, Julie delivered a son, Beckett.
And then a second one. And the experience I have with both, it's hard to put into words. It's hard to tell you what it's like being a mom. That's almost impossible. It's just the greatest thing that's ever happened to me.
There's some people who are so unorganically parents, and others that are very smoothly and naturally parents. And Melissa is a great parent.
I think motherhood has changed Melissa to a certain degree. I think she has a greater love for the world and wanting to make the world a better place, because she has kids that are going to be part of the future at this point.
Coming up, rumors about the baby's father run rampant.
We heard Brad Pitt. That was the big one.
And later,
I turn around and it's Meg Ryan and Laura Dern.
In October 99, Melissa Etheridge released her sixth album, Breakdown. She garnered 3 Grammy nominations for the record. The rock star was flying high. Success, love, 2 kids, no more secrets, well, maybe 1. Fans wanted to know, who was the father of her children?
Once Julie was pregnant and our children were born, we thought that the world just didn't need to know. That it was just, you know, it's our business. And this was a very personal thing, very, very personal thing.
But rumors circulated like wildfire.
Basically, any man who was seen with or knew us at all was suspect. Our band members, my tour manager.
My parents asked me, are you the father, Stephen?
Any star, of course, that we knew.
We heard Brad Pitt. That was the big one.
You know, Tom Hanks, Bruce Springsteen, my idol. Well, of course, I'd ask him to father my children.
Melissa got a kick out of the speculation.
You know, that's the great thing about Melissa. She really is unfazed by all the media circus that goes on around her.
But there was a serious side to the issue. Bailey started asking about her daddy.
And I started thinking about my children. I started thinking about them in school. And I didn't want to leave them open to someone who might approach them and go, hey, who's your daddy? Who's your father? So Julie and I discussed it, and we said, you know what? Let's just, while they're little, while they don't feel the rest of the world, let's get this out. Let's get it over with.
Everyone was asking her, and she just felt like it was becoming bigger than it should be.
In January of 2000, Melissa and Julie put the rumors to rest when they announced that musician David Crosby fathered the children.
We really didn't think it would have the reaction that it did. It was crazy there for a couple of weeks. And I guess looking back, yeah, David Crosby and Melissa Etheridge, I guess that's a big thing. But it was such a personal thing, such a personal level for me, that the whole world's reaction to it was kind of overwhelming to me.
I think it was a big relief for her when they announced that David was the father, because it wasn't anything she was ashamed of. You know, it was somebody that they really handpicked and were really proud of.
But just how did they handpick David Crosby? Flashback to the spring of 95.
We were in Hawaii vacationing and saw that our friends, David and Jan Crosby, were there also. And we're talking to them. They had just had a baby, and we were talking about how we might want to and all the issues that we were going through.
They were having a hard time, and they shared that with us, that they were having a hard time finding a path to take, a way to be donated what they needed to make a family, start a family, and they were very interested in starting a family.
And then Jan said, well, have you thought about David? And David said, yeah, have you thought about me?
They were a little shocked and very pleased, I think. And I think it was a path that they hadn't suspected would open up for them.
It was a year later that we called them up and said, is that indeed an offer? And if it is, I think this is the perfect situation.
I think that we gave it as a gift with no strings attached to it, and that it was coming from a place of very generous spirit on Jan's part. I think that made it right, you know, it made it feel right.
The Crosbys' gift may have felt right, but for Melissa and Julie as a couple, something was beginning to feel wrong coming up.
I didn't want to have to say, you know, I've done this and this, and here's a failure. Just a little
more. In September of 2000, in a statement from Island Records, Melissa Etheridge announced that she and Julie Cypher were calling it quits.
When it came time to announce the breakup, it was a, you know, something I didn't want to do. I didn't want to have to say, you know, I've done this and this, and here's a failure, is what it basically felt like.
You know what we should be talking about? A really long-term gay relationship, which was a great example and inspiration for a lot of people.
And they worked together diligently every day to be friends and partners as parents.
The couple agreed to share custody of the children.
Julie and I knew that we would forever be in each other's lives because we are the two mothers of two children. And those children are more important than ourselves.
Melissa and Julie decided on a very unique living arrangement.
They have two adjacent homes, and the kids go back and forth between the two houses. They're back to back, they have a gate, and the kids, you know, feel that the entire place is theirs, and it is.
Any couple will have hardships, and not all of them take the path that these two women are taking.
If I'm going to be able to stand up and be honest about my world and my sexuality and my life and have people look at it and say, bravo, good for you, then I need to be able to do it even in the bad times.
Despite the personal changes, Melissa continued making music. In 2001, she recorded a seventh album.
An album that is entitled Skin, because of the references so many times in the songs to my new skin, my taking off of the skin, my putting, getting back into my skin, my change. This has been a huge year of change for me.
Record producer David Cole.
From one end of the record to the other, it goes through the whole phase of a relationship crumbling around you. And at the end of it, she comes out the other side of it, picks herself up, dusts herself off, and moves on.
The songs are about my experience with Julie, my experience of being in love, of my own heartbreak and change, my own examination then of myself.
When she wrote a line or a lyric that kind of said what she wanted to say but didn't really address it, I'd bring it up to her and I'd try and draw it out of her.
This is the way I express. This is the way I deal with it and go through it. And I wrote my songs, my experience.
For this album, Melissa enlisted the help of two neophyte backup singers.
And she goes, oh, David, I want you to meet Meg and Laura. Yeah, hi, how you doing? And I turn around and it's Meg Ryan and Laura Dern.
Meg and I have been, you know, playing that for all it's worth for the last several months, going, yeah, we're coming out with a new record.
Etheridge just may have created a couple of budding rock stars. She also decided to embark in a new direction. Melissa started work on her autobiography.
Writing of this book became incredible therapy. I would sit down and I would go through my past, and then I would compare it to what I was going through right now, and it was an examination of my whole life so far.
In her very telling book, entitled The Truth Is, Etheridge alleged that she was sexually abused as a child.
I knew that I could not leave any part out, even the parts that would be uncomfortable or shameful or might hurt people that I love very much. I had to make a choice that would not be healing if I kept some in little boxes still and left them in. I would have to take them with me. So to talk about my childhood was a difficult choice. It was a good experience, though, and I don't regret it.
That wasn't the only secret. Melissa revealed the reason for her split with Julie. Cypher proclaimed, "I'm not gay," and returned to dating men. In May 2001, Melissa began moving on with her personal life by dating actress Tammy Lynn Michaels.
I'm so beginning, and I feel fresher and stronger. So I am making some choices for myself to enjoy and to be in it, because it's very new and strong.
It's been quite a ride. Seems like the little girl from Leavenworth realized just about all the dreams she ever had.
What you see is what you get, and what you get is a friendly face and a big heart and someone who really cares about people.
Really, there's no voice like her. I think when she gets up on stage, she is like a reincarnation of Janis Joplin.
It's just insane rock music with this incredible voice that you just, you know, you feel like you're watching, you know, Woodstock documentary, and you're back like watching Janis and Jimi Hendrix and going, God, why can't we have great music? Oh, yeah, it's right here. We've got Melissa Etheridge.
It has been a journey, and there's not been anything that I would change. There have been painful times, but through that pain and by going through the pain, I have grown, become stronger, and moved on down my path where I might have been stuck if I hadn't gone through it. I'm still going. I have a long way to go. You know, talk to me again in a few years. We'll do this again, and I'll have some more stories for you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Who is the personification of cool? Brad Pitt. What cartoon or comic book character would you like to be for a day? And why? I'd like to be Spider-Man.